Started. Can you hear me with the microphone? Is that working?
Yes, you're live.
I'm live. Okay, all right. So I'd like to welcome everyone. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you to my students who are here, which is great. Thank you to other students. Thank you to community members and faculty for being here. We're really excited for this talk. Excited for the bagels, too. Before we get started, I do just want to acknowledge the events of this past weekend and the war that is taking place right now, which there's been horrific loss of life, and we just want to acknowledge that and to acknowledge that it brings up a lot of emotions for a lot of people. It's very difficult for a lot of people, and so just to be empathetic and to sort of to be considering what people are thinking about and going through, because it was so difficult. So thank you, and thank you to Sarah for being here during this really difficult time, and thank you to all of you for being here during this really difficult time as well. Okay, so I'm Kirsten from English. For people who don't know me, I'm associate director of Jewish Studies this year, the Jewish Studies program in Sterling Institute, and I'm also in the History Department, and I'm thrilled to be here to introduce a friend and colleague, Sarah Bunin Benor, who does amazing work, and we are thrilled that she was able to come to speak as part of our program on Yiddish. I want to be able to thank, and before I get started, I want to thank a lot of people who have helped to make this happen. We have co-sponsors, the College of Arts and Letters, James Madison College, the College of Social Science, the Residential College of Arts and Humanities, International Studies, I don't want to mess anybody up, International Studies and Programs, Office of Institutional Diversity and Inclusion, Department of Linguistics, Languages and Cultures, Department of History, and the Department of Religious Studies. Okay, I know. And I want to make a special thanks to the Department of Linguistics and Languages, and particularly to Suzanne Wegner and to Betsy Sneller and Chantal Tetro. Oh, Chantal Tetro is a different department. Sorry. But I want to thank in particular Betsy and Suzanne and the Department of Linguistics and Languages for being really, really helpful in making this a terrific experience to be able to bring Sarah to campus. So thank you very much for everything. And now I want to... It's all altruism, right?
1 second. These are Professor Steve Ratkin's homemade baked bagels. So he just brought them out, passed them around.
Okay.
But these are the best ones.
So everything that you all are eating is crap, is what she means to say. Yeah, that's right. Just take it. So let me please introduce Sarah Bunin Benor. She is vice provost and professor of contemporary Jewish studies at Hebrew Union College, JIR, Jewish Institute of Religion, in Los Angeles, and adjunct professor at the University of Southern California Linguistics Department. She received her PhD from Stanford University in Linguistics in 2004. Her fantastic books include Becoming From, How Newcomers Learn the Language and Culture of Orthodox Judaism, which was published by Rutgers University Press in 2012 and won the 2013 Sammy Rohr Award, and Hebrew Infusion, Language and Community at American Jewish Summer Camps, published by Rutgers University Press in 2020 and won the National Jewish Book Award for Jewish Education and Identity. Dr. Benor is the founding co-editor of the Journal of Jewish Languages, and she directs the HUC JIR Jewish Language Project, which my students heard about today, which is really just so exciting, which features the Jewish language website and the Jewish English Lexicon. And we are just thrilled to have you here. So please give it a warm hand and welcome.
It's fine. Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for having me. I'm really happy to be here, and what a wonderful Jewish studies community, linguistics community, and general community you have here. It's really a pleasure to be part of this wonderful community. So I'm going to start with some quotes. And some of you might hear a quote and you will say, I've never heard anything like that before. And others of you might hear a quote and say, oh, that sounds really familiar. So I'm going to ask you, for those who have heard a quote like this, what type of person might have said a quote like this? Okay? Here's the first one. Oh, it's not on there. Hold on. I think we need to redo this. Maybe we have to, I don't know. It's just, okay, I'll try unplugging it and plugging it in again. Oh, there we go. Okay. Okay, here we go. So here's the first quote. I can't believe Jeremy co-chaired the campaign. He's always been a mensch, and now he's a real macher. You must be shepping so much naches right now. So what type of person might say a quote like this? What?
A bubby.
A bubby. Okay, so an older woman, right? A bubby is Yiddish for grandmother, and an older woman might say a quote like this. How about this? The sugya we're learning is too lumdish to say outside. Yeah? What? Oh, a chosid, yeah. So a yeshiva bacher, a person who studies in a yeshiva, right? And wait, here, actually, would you mind helping me get it back to the other mode? Sorry, it's just a little distracting with the bottom things
very
moving.
Best that I can. What did we do last time?
I don't remember. It must have been one of these things. There we go. Thank you. Right, okay, how about this one? After I was bat mitzvahed, I only went to temple for tikkun olam events.
A reformed Jew.
A reformed Jew, specifically female, right? Okay. And you guys can all see the screen okay, right? Okay. How about this one? I'm going to call for my nono's meldado. Different. Yeah? Yes, a Sephardic Jew, very good. I specifically heard this phrase in Seattle, in the Sephardic community there. I traded my payas for cornrows, my yarmulkes for fitted hats, Seder plates for soul food, Magenta beads for dog tags. I'm a represent for Sammy Davis Jr. and Lenny Kravitz. Anyone who might say this?
Black Jew.
A black Jew, yeah, this is from a spoken word performance called Black and Jewish by the poet Aaron Samuels. The Gabbai wants to know who's laning the Maftir Aliyah and who's Hagba and Galila.
Someone at our synagogue.
Yeah, it's mostly non-Orthodox synagogue, maybe conservative or maybe modern Orthodox or non-denominational Reconstructionist, yeah. And I left my koracha in Knis. Anyone? A Syrian Jew. This is, it has a word from Ladino in it actually, but it's that Ladino word has become part of Judeo-Arabic, and Knis is a Judeo-Arabic word for synagogue. I spent the whole party schmoozing up the vice president. I must have given my spiel 6 times.
Yeah.
Anybody. Exactly. It doesn't have to be a Jew. It doesn't have to be someone who knows where these words come from. These are words that have become part of the American lexicon. And the last one. In the middle of the coldest weather, he crossed the ice in a little boat. He should catch the British and the missionaries fooling around, not with their minds on the war.
My grandmother.
Your grandmother. So someone with a Yiddish accent, right? And this is from a book by Leo Rostin, The Education of Hyman Kaplan. So what do all of these quotes have in common?
They're in English.
They're in English. Mm-hmm. What else?
They use words that have some sort of like origin in like, you know, Jewish sayings and whatnot.
That's it. Those are the two things. And together, this makes Jewish American English. But it's an abstraction. It's an umbrella term for the ways that Jews in America speak English. with distinctive features, including influences from textual Hebrew and Aramaic, modern Hebrew, Yiddish, Ladino, Russian, Farsi, Arabic, and other languages. And this is also the case for other ethnic dialects like Black English, Latino English, Asian English. These are all abstractions. They are terms that are used to represent a lot of diversity. Within each of these ways of speaking, there are many ways of speaking. And that's the same with Jewish languages. Any Jewish language from any part of the world is an abstraction and represents a lot of diversity. So when we think about Judeo-Arabic, there are many dialects of Judeo-Arabic, or Jewish Malayalam in southern India, people from different parts of that region speak in different ways. So I'm going to give you some data now from a survey that I conducted in 2008 of American Jewish language and identity. And I'm going to show you how language use correlates with age, religiosity, denomination, Israel connections, and Jewish friends, and more. So we asked people if they used certain words, and if so, with Jews or also with non-Jews. And so I'm going to give you the data on just whether they use these words. So this is the percent of Jews who use the word macher, which means big shot. And what do you notice?
It goes down.
Like the younger people are less likely to use this word than the older people. Okay, so that's what you'd expect. You'd expect that from a Yiddish word where we're getting farther removed from the generation from immigration, right? That's the case with a lot of these words. Kepi, Nachis, Hamish, Bashert. These words are all diminishing over time. But we see the opposite trend with some words, like drash, which is a word from Hebrew, meaning a sermon or an interpretation, that younger Jews are more likely than older Jews to use it, but not as high. Like you saw in the last one, it went up to 80%. This only goes up to 20-something percent, right? So a smaller percentage of the American Jewish population uses a word like drash. But you also see increases like this in words like yofi, also from Hebrew, hamevin, yavin. Those in the know will understand. And you see surprising age trends for some Yiddish words too. So for example, the word lein, meaning to read Torah, to chant Torah, and other words from Yiddish that are in the religious domain, like shul, daven, and bench. And grammatical influences from Yiddish, like staying by us, meaning staying at our house. You also see correlations with synagogue attendance. So the more frequently people report attending synagogue, the more likely they are to use certain linguistic features, including tachlis, which means the purpose, the bottom line, like let's stop talking about all these highfalutin down to tachlis, right? And so people who attend synagogue twice a month or more are much more likely to use this word than those who rarely attend. We see correlations with denomination. Reform Jews are much less likely to use certain words like davka than black hat and modern Orthodox Jews. We just finished the holiday of Sukkot, also known as Sukkis. And Sukkis is the Ashkenazic pronunciation, whereas Sukkot is the more modern Hebrew-influenced pronunciation. And we see that the Ashkenazi pronunciation is more common in black hat and Orthodox communities than among non-Orthodox Jews. Same with the greeting that we said a few weeks ago between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, the two high holidays that are 10 days apart. Do you say Gmar Chsima Toive or do you say Gmar Chatima Tova? The way you pronounce that phrase tells people where you are on the Orthodox continuum. It also correlates with time spent in Israel. So those who've spent over a year in Israel, almost everyone in that group reports that they use the word balagan, whereas those who've rarely been in Israel or who have spent no more than 2 weeks on any one trip in Israel, hardly any of them use it. And I guess that's an appropriate way to describe the current situation, unfortunately. The word schmooze, what does it mean? To you, what does it mean?
Socialize.
Okay.
Have a cozy talk.
Okay. Anyone have any other definitions for it? Yeah?
Socialize with intention to gain something.
Aha.
Interaction.
Okay. So these are two different meanings, related, but we found variation on that. It doesn't mean to chat or does it mean to network? And so here's what we found. This is the percent that report the chat meaning. And we find that Jews are more likely than non-Jews to report using the chat meaning. This is Jews and this is non-Jews. But we also see how it correlates with the percentage of Jewish friends that people have. So if you say that most of your friends are Jewish, you're more likely to report using the chat meaning than if you have no Jewish friends, right? Yes. So now I want to turn to diversity of Jewish English based on a study that I did of Jewish summer camps around North America. This is a study that I did with my colleagues, Jonathan Krasner and Sharon Avni. And we got to visit lots of camps. It was really fun. And I'm going to give you just a sampling of the camps that we visited. We found that Hebrew is the primary language infused at most of the camps that we visited, including Reform camps, Zionist movement camps, conservative camps, and then a few camps that have Hebrew immersion programs. And then we found a few camps where other languages are infused into the primarily English environment, including Yiddish, Ladino, and Russian. So I'll give you some examples of these. This is from a Union for Reform Judaism camp, and Chadar Ochel means dining hall. And you'll see it's written in English letters, right? It's transliterated. But they also use Hebrew for prayers, which they call tefillah, singing, which they call shirah, and for signs around the camp and words incorporated into English. Here's an example from Birkat HaMazon, the grace after meals. And you can see how it's written both in Hebrew and in transliteration. This is from a progressive Zionist camp movement. And here's a blog post excerpt that they sent to parents. At the end of Hitkansut Boker, the Chanichim and Madrichim sit in front of the Torah to enjoy a mini Hatzagah. Sounds familiar, right? we both have kids in this movement who have gone to these camps. And, you know, is this English? What do you think? Kind of. I mean, it's what we call camp Hebraized English, right? So it's English, but it has a lot of Hebrew words such that without the things in parentheses, you really wouldn't understand it if you didn't already know the lingo. Here's from a B'nai Akiva camp, which is a religious Zionist camp movement, or youth movement. And so here's Birkat HaMazon, that same, it's a slightly different prayer, but anyway. So this is a Hebrew prayer, and notice it is only in Hebrew, and in this case it's in cursive Hebrew, and there's no transliteration. Also, their color war includes Hebrew cheers and team names. Here's a quote that I heard at Camp Ramah, which is a conservative movement camp. Boker tov chanichim, please go back to your tzrifim, get your bigdei yam, and then meet at the brecha. So again, if you don't know these words, it would be hard to understand it, but you don't need to know Hebrew to understand it. You just need to know the Hebrew loan words that are used at this camp. However, they do something a little more Hebrew intensive at some Ramah camps. This one's from Ramah in Wisconsin. They do their plays in Hebrew. So I'm going to play a clip from Frozen in Hebrew. Okay. So And then there are some camps that are Hebrew immersion, where the entire camp is conducted in Hebrew, or a program within the camp is conducted in Hebrew. And but even there, the side conversations are usually in English. So here are some examples of other languages infused at some camps. This is from Camp Kindering, which is historically a socialist Yiddishist camp in upstate New York, or near New York City. And now it is not so, and it was historically like militantly secularist, not militantly, but very secularist. Now it is no longer socialist, but they do, and they do some blessings and prayers, but they do still have some Yiddish culture. And so they sing Yiddish songs, and they have a Holocaust survivor who tells stories in a Yiddish accent, and teaches them about Yiddish culture. And we see a similar process at Sephardic Adventure Camp, which is a camp near Seattle that is primarily attended by the great-grandchildren of immigrants from Greece and Turkey who moved to Seattle and to other parts of the country. And they get extra points in their color war for using Ladino on their banners, this banner that became a mechitza, a separation between the men and the women in an Orthodox synagogue. It was from their color war, and it has a quote from Pirkei Avot, from a rabbinic text in Hebrew, English, and Ladino. And they actually get, their song has some Ladino phrases in it, so it's a Ladino-infused English song. I'll just sing a little bit of it. It's the Ojo de Chamsa, we're the king of all camps, having front and playing with our counselors. And it must be known that the legend lives on, cause we know that S-A-C está muy bueno. So they have a lot of fun with it. And so for them, the Ladino parts are a way of connecting to their ancestral culture. And finally, we visited Gesher, which is a Russian-American camp. And you can see how they do the backwards R in the name of their camp, right? And it says, welcome to, and privyet, I think that's how you say it, welcome to Gesher, or camp, or whatever it says. But the way that Russian is infused here, it's not really infused. It's more like what we call in linguistics translanguaging, where you mix two languages together in a way that only other bilinguals can understand. And because this is a camp where all the kids speak both Russian and English, and the counselors do too. And so they would mostly speak English, but then sometimes Russian, and then when the kids were upset, they would calm them in Russian, or they would yell at them in Russian. It was kind of like a parental move to switch to Russian. So what we see here is that Jews use language to indicate their Jewish identities. Not just that they're Jewish, but that they're a certain type of Jew, okay? So here are some examples. Can anyone read this one in the middle? It says Michigan State. And that one says Shalom, y'all, as you can see. This one says Yankees and Angels. So what are your favorite sports teams, or your region, or your university? Now, why would someone choose to have a shirt like this or a hat like this in Hebrew letters? Like, why not just have a Michigan State Jews shirt or something like that?
Well, what do you think? Group members can't read it.
Okay, so it's kind of like an in-group thing, right? It shows that you are an in-group member that has enough Hebrew knowledge to be able to read it, right? It's kind of like the phrase I used before, hamevin yavin, those in the know will get it. And other people will be like, huh, that's an interesting shirt, I wonder what it says. Sexual orientation, here you have kosher queer, where it's faux Hebrew letters. So in that case, it's not the, you have to know the Hebrew alphabet to be able to read it, but it has still some Jewish valence. And this one says OQ instead of OU, which is a symbol of keeping kosher. We see this in politics too. So here you see a button that says Clinton, Barack Obama, Nixon, and then this one says Gore and Gore Nisht, which is a hilarious joke if you get it. I'll explain it. So Al Gore, and then Gore Nisht literally means not Gore, but it is also the Yiddish word for nothing. And so it was clearly a dig at Bush in the Bush v. Gore race that some of us remember very well. Okay. So now, I titled the talk Beyond Bagels and Burekas, and I see we have bagels. I'm very excited to try the ones that you brought. Thank you. Hope there's one left by the end of the talk. So bagels are an Ashkenazi food, but they're not actually an import from Eastern Europe. It's actually a great story. I highly recommend an article by Jeff Marks that explains the history of it. Have you guys, anyone read this? It's really good. The on one foot version is that the bagels that were brought to America by Polish Jews were initially, they were hard. They were more like a hard pretzel. And they were dark flour, but then when they encountered white flour in America, they started using that, and it got much bigger, big enough that you could spread cream cheese on it. And then the cream cheese industry was marketing to Jews in Yiddish newspapers and got a lot of traction there. And then lox came in because it was being imported. Do you call it imported if it's from Seattle? I don't know. It was being imported from the Pacific Northwest to New York, because of new refrigeration technology in train transportation. And so all of that came together in the mid-20th century when Jews were upwardly mobile, and this was a way of highlighting their new social status, and the bagels, lox, cream cheese thing became associated with Jews in New York. Burekas are from the Sephardic world, from various places, including Greece and Turkey, Yugoslavia, and they became part of Sephardic culture in Israel and in America, and just Israeli food more generally. But so here, someone has a shirt, bagels not, burekas not bagels, which is indicating I am a Sephardic Jew, not an Ashkenazi Jew, right? And again, you have the faux Hebrew lettering with the mensch, meaning a good person, and these Yiddish refrigerator magnets, right? If you have these Yiddish refrigerator magnets, you can't actually form a full sentence in Yiddish, as Jeffrey Chandler talks about in his book, Adventures in Yiddish Land, but you can highlight your connection to the Yiddish language. So I'm gonna give you some information now about Yiddish-influenced English. Remember that quote at the beginning from Education of Hyman Kaplan? This is similar. This is a this is an imitation of the way that immigrants whose native language is Yiddish would speak English. And this is from a comedy book by Milt Gross from 1928. So, die first human being what it existed was entitled Hedem. So, Hedem lived gradually in a place what it was, die Garden from Eden. So, in die Garden from Eden was extremely gorgeous. What it was, there all kinds from fancy fruits. Okay, so this is Yiddish influenced, but in a very different way than the Yiddish influenced quotes that we used before. There are no words from Yiddish, right? It's influenced by Yiddish in phonology and pronunciation, and in grammar, and in some word choice, like from instead of, because in Yiddish that's the same word. And so this is the kind of Yiddish-influenced English that you'd get in the immigrant generation. Then you also get this in contemporary Orthodox communities. Here's another quote that has a lot of Yiddish influences that I heard in my research in Philadelphia in 2001. If you have children by the Seder, it's time to go ahead and focus on the children, to tell them over about emuna, trust and belief in Hashem, and to give over the Seder. So you have some Hebrew words, emuna and Hashem, and you have some Yiddish grammatical influences, the by and to tell over, that phrasal verb, give over. And so this is a very common way of speaking English in Orthodox communities today. And now I'm going to show you how these two types of Yiddish-influenced English play out in songs. I'm going to play some songs in Yeshivish and some songs in Yinglish. The Yinglish songs are by Mickey Katz and Seymour Rechtzeit, and the Yeshivish songs are by Country Yossi and Journeys. So Mickey Katz was born in Cleveland in 1909. He grew up in a community of Yiddish speakers, but he himself was American born. So really he had access to both of these repertoires. He was himself very, very strongly bilingual.
Of the Lancy Street, home of gefilte fish and kosher meat. Handy mit a knife for here's your tea. You flicked him a chicken when he was only three. He sat in the sun and geracket in gebacket. He fought in the annals. Then came the Litvax and the Galicianers. A figurehugged redskins all over the shtetl. He never lost his head. He never lost his shtetl. He chewed tobacco and gehissed and gehracket. King of the Lens history.
Okay, so we have some language that would be considered racist today, right? And we also have a lot of Yiddish words, right? We have phrases where he completely switches to Yiddish, like ungeraket, ungebaket. But then some of them are just loan words, like gefilte fish and kosher, that you still hear in Jewish English today and beyond Jewish English in general English. And then we have, so then here's another song that does something kind of similar. This is by Seymour Rechtzeit. He was born in Poland, but you'll hear his speech sounds very American because he came to America when he was quite young. This is a parody of a song that was quite popular in the 1940s and 50s, The Syncopated Clock.
He loved his schnapps like a good Litvak, but his greatest love was to fix a clock. Now Avrum Yitzhak once last year had schnapps gemischt mit a bottle full of beer. Was hot passiert to his career, made Avrum schreißes a klug zu mir.
Okay, now here you see that there's even a little more mixing. You kind of have to be bilingual to understand this without the parentheses, right? He's not just using loan words. I mean, even in the Mickey Katz one, he was really not using just loan words. He was translanguaging, mixing the languages kind of indiscriminately. This is quite different from the yeshivish songs. In the yeshivish songs, you'll see a lot more what we call loan words, words from one language used within another language that are where you don't need to know the other language. You just need to know English, but you these are words that are frequently used within English in certain communities and are integrated phonologically. They're integrated into the sound system of English for the most part and into the grammar system. So this first song is by Country Yossi and the Stiebelhoppers. Stiebel means little house or little synagogue. And so this is a parody of a song that was also quite popular at the time, Big Bad John by Jimmy Dean from 1961. And this one's called Big Bad Moish.
Every morning in the stiebel you could see him arrive. He stood 6'6", weighed 245, kind of broad at the garden, hairy at the lip. And everybody knew you didn't pull no shtick to Big Moish.
Big
Mush, Big Mush, Big Bad
Mush, Big Mush.
No one seemed to know where Moish called home. He just drifted into shul, davened alone. Didn't say much, just a main here and there. And if he said shalom, he'd pretend not to hear Big Moish. Some people said he lived in Borough Park, where he liked to roam the streets after dark. And he once got jumped by a three-billed affair, but they all ended up teeth in dreary. Big Moish.
So here you do have some full phrases, tiefendrared and wildefaired, but these are phrases that were popular among the children of immigrants, right? You don't need to be fully bilingual to understand these phrases. And most of the influences from Yiddish that he has here are, well, and from Hebrew, are words, are loan words. Shul, davened, see how it's integrated into the English structure, right? Amen and shalom. And the final song is by A.B. Rotenberg from the band Journeys. The song is called Yeshiva Shared, which literally means yeshiva speech. And yeshiva is an Orthodox Jewish school system. And it's people who attend an Orthodox school that that speak in this way.
To originate a language, a new way to talk and speak is a most imposing challenge, a monumental feat. It takes a special talent, is not for the faint of heart, and most are doomed to failure before they even start. But in the hallowed halls of yeshivos far and wide, our young men have discovered a new way to verbalize. With Yiddish, English, Hebrew, it's a mixture of all three. And the dash of Aramaic, a linguistic potpourri that's called
Yeshiva Sherei, Yeshiva Sheshprach, Taka Epis Grade Agamaldegaza. It's called Yeshiva Sherei, Yeshiva Sheshprach, it's the talk of the town.
And it goes on and on with more more Yiddish and Hebrew and Aramaic phrases. So this one also seems like it's a lot of non-English words. There's a lot of underlines, right? But it's kind of the exception that proves the rule because it is loan words. It's just a list of loan words that they use. It's not like they're actually saying a whole sentence in these other languages. So if we want to compare these two types of songs, we say there's some similarities. They're both English-based and have some Yiddish words. But then there's a lot of differences. The topics are different. The Yinglish ones talk about food and the immigrant experience, whereas the Yeshivish ones talk about learning and praying and the Orthodox experience. There are no full Yiddish sentences in the Yeshivish ones, hardly any Yiddish pronunciations. Well, you do get the Yeshivish reid, you get the r, like a tap on the front of the mouth instead of a r that most English speakers use. Very little Yiddish pronunciation and no distinctive grammatical influences from Yiddish. So I'll just end with a quote by H.B. Wells, not to be confused with H.G. Wells, from 1928, who said, "Judeo-German, meaning Yiddish, in America is inevitably doomed. There is no reasonable doubt that the American Yiddish will, within a very few years, lose its identity, at least as Judeo-German, will turn into Judeo-English, expire quietly, and finally become as delightfully musty and passé a subject for doctor's theses as Anglo-Saxon is today." Now, I do agree with H.B. Wells about the being a good topic for a dissertation, but I disagree about the expiring quietly because it's actually expanding, right? As we saw, some of the words are decreasing over the year. The age, that younger people are less likely to say these words, but some are actually increasing, right? And so as I found in my book, Becoming From, which was based on my dissertation, you know, not on Anglo-Saxon, but on Yeshivish, I did find that younger people are much more likely than older people to use certain Yiddish influences. And as we can see in the Jewish English lexicon, that there are, which is a collection of words, it's an online dictionary that I run that has I think 2,800 words or something like that. A lot of them are from Yiddish, but also from other languages. And these words, the fact that there are so many words, 2,800 words used by English-speaking Jews that are distinct, is a sign of the language being quite vibrant. So when we think about Jewish American English, it's influenced by many immigrant languages, by Israeli Hebrew, by Persian or Farsi, and some endangered languages spoken by the Jews of Iran, like Judeo-Shirazi and Judeo-Hamadani, by the Judeo-Arabic of Jews from the Middle East, Russian from Jews who came from the Soviet Union, French and Latin American Spanish, Yiddish, Ladino, and more. And so, and in addition to these immigrant languages, we see that American Jews of many backgrounds use words from textual Hebrew, modern Hebrew, and various immigrant languages in diverse ways. And so we use our language to show not just that we are American Jews, but that we are certain types of American Jews. And I'll just end with these cute little tchotchkes, which is a Yiddish word meaning like trinkets. This one says, bar mitzvah and bark mitzvah and bat mitzvah. And so yeah, we're not just the people of the book, we're also the people of the pun. Thank you very much. And I think we have time for questions. Or comments. Yeah.
Oh, can you reach it?
Thanks.
There you go.
Yeah, thank you so much for such an interesting talk. It was really fun and wonderful. I'm wondering about audience design or the ways that especially some of the more public kinds of producers of music and language that you talked about, how do you think they are maybe designing certain ways of integrating loanwords or, you know, sort of formulating their song speech in order to have a crossover audience? I don't know if you've thought about that, but I was just interested in audience and sort of also maybe some stereotypes and thinking about how, you know, certain kinds of stereotypes are really effective for kind of marshaling certain ideas about personhood, but then might cross over and be a little bit different for different audiences. So
yes.
It's kind of a lot of questions. But
yeah, okay, well, I'll start with the first one. I think people are very aware of their audiences. And some of the language that I've reported on today is performance language. It's language from a spoken word performance or from a book that is intended for audiences, right? And so I think those are very self-conscious and intentional performances. And actually, I'm giving a talk at the Association for Jewish Studies conference in December this year about Yiddish on YouTube and how people are consciously using Yiddish and English and mixing them in interesting ways on videos for various educational purposes and also entertainment purposes. Mm-hmm. But I think audience design is such an important part of what's going on here, so much so that when I did my survey in 2008, I initially said, do you say this word? And then when I did the pilot version, which is so important if you're ever doing a survey, you have to do the pilot. You have to do a lot of pilot versions. I found that people said, well, yeah, I use it, but I only use it when I'm talking to Jews. And I realized I needed to ask about that too. But then I realized I also needed to ask about which types of Jews. So I think we ended up having some questions where there were multiple options. Yes, I use this word with Jews and non-Jews. Yes, I use this word with Jews. Yes, I use this word, but only with Jews who are religiously engaged. Mm-hmm. And we got very different answers. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, what do you call the spring holiday? Mm-hmm. Do you call it Passover, Pesach, or Pesach? And so there's different answers when you're talking to different audiences. Mm-hmm. And so in that way, the audience design thing is very apparent. And very conscious. I think people are very aware, like, yeah, when I'm talking to my Jewy friends, I say shul, but when I'm talking to my Jewish friends who are less Jewy, I say synagogue. And then if I'm talking to my Reform friends, I'll say temple. So, you know, there's all different ways of saying things to different audiences. What was the second question?
Oh, just how stereotypes play into that. Maybe marshalling certain kinds of, and maybe stereotypes is too strong a word, but in a sense, speech that might be formulaic to a point of maybe marshalling up certain kinds of stereotypes. Is it, I don't know if that is part of your study or...
Yeah, okay, so the question's about stereotypes and how people are marshalling stereotypes in their decisions about language. Yeah. I think people are somewhat aware of that. I guess it depends who is the intended audience. Mm-hmm. I think in performances, sometimes people play up the stereotypical language for comedy purposes. For example, there's another video called Black and Jewish, which is actually a parody of the song Black and Yellow. And it's done by Callie Hawk and Katarina Graham, who are both black Jews. And it's very funny and also extremely stereotypical. Like it really highlights stereotypical features of Jewish English and black English and Jewish culture and black culture more broadly. And they're really highlighting these stereotypical features as a way of saying, hey, look, black Jews, we're here, you know? But also maybe questioning whether being black and Jewish means that you have to be completely entrenched in both communities. Like, you know, it's kind of ridiculous, the idea that people would be using all of these stereotypical linguistic and cultural practices, and yet they're highlighting that as a way of highlighting that they exist.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Sarah, for this lovely talk. I wanted to ask about summer camps, and I guess in line with the question about audience, how do counselors and camp directors integrate campers who are not familiar with some of the lexical items and other aspects of Jewish languages that they're encountering? In other words, how do you make campers become the in-group when mm-hmm. some of them might feel like the out-group when they arrive? What did you observe?
Yes, so this is a process of language socialization, which is where you socialize people to be part of a community, partly by using and teaching the language of the community, and at the same time, you're socializing them to be part of the language, to be able to use the language. And that happens in various ways in camps. So, for example, at the very beginning of a session, you'll have a lot more translation. So a phrase like Chanichim and Madrichim go to the Teatron for Pe'ulat Erev, you'll like, at the beginning of the camp session, they'll say Chanichim, that means campers, and then Teatron means the theater, it's over there. And, you know, just like there's an orientation to the places around camp, there's a little bit of an orientation to the lingo of camp. But some of it just happens more organically, that people pick it up. And the best way to learn language is to hear and use it, not to be taught it, right? And not for someone to say, this is how you say this word. And so you do get that a lot at camp. But I did also hear a lot of instances of people doing overt instruction, like saying when the camp leader was saying a big ma'agal with everybody in it, which means a big circle with everybody in it. ma'agal means circle. So then I heard a counselor turn to a new camper who was there for just a short session and say, come on, let's go make a circle. Ma'agal means circle. So she could have just said, let's go make a circle, but she wanted to teach that word in addition to teaching them, in addition to orienting the camper to what was going on. And some of the language infusion that happens at camp is very intentionally pedagogical. So you'll get things like, let's go to the Agam, lake, Agam. And then they clap, and they call it a Hebrew sandwich because it's Agam means lake, and then they have the Hebrew is the outside, and then the English word is in the middle. I guess it's more of an English sandwich. But then they do this, which, you know, highlights that it's a sandwich, but it also kind of brings people's attention to it in a sense. It highlights it as something important. In that case, they actually want them to learn that Agam means lake. But other times they'll use a Hebrew word and they don't really care if they remember it, like the Israeli counselor who stands at the top of the water slide and won't let the kid go down until she says a Hebrew word And then, you know, she goes down and it was earring or something, and she didn't remember how to say earring the next day, but it didn't matter. She remembered that was a fun experience. So she associated Hebrew with fun, right? And so a lot of the pedagogical work that happens at these summer camps with Hebrew is not about them going home and being able to speak the language or even remembering words, but rather highlighting the associations of Hebrew and fun. And I'll be speaking about that tomorrow in your class, right? Yeah. Other questions? Yes.
Have you looked at the influence of like the internet and social media with this, or the intersection thereof, like with youth and like younger Jewish speakers, or even with you know, middle-aged or older speakers who also obviously use the internet? But you know, like, have you thought about that sort of connection?
Yeah, that is a great domain for research, because there's a lot of data there. And so if anyone's interested in doing research on that, I'm happy to advise. And so, yeah, there's a lot of Jewish language on the internet and a lot of people using Jewish language in a way that is intended as an in-group conversation. But even if not all of the members of their social media platform are part of that group. So it's pretty interesting to see how language is used in that way. And so, yeah, there's a lot of the Jewish English that I've been talking about today can be found on various internet platforms. A good example is there's a forum called I'm a Mother, which is also, it's kind of a pun because it's also Ima Mother, and Ima means mother in Hebrew. And it's a forum for Orthodox mothers. And it has great data. I've used it a lot for example sentences for my Jewish English lexicon, I find a word there and then I'll put it on the lexicon and use it as an example sentence. But there's very little translation there because it's an in-group forum for Orthodox women.
So I just wanted to mention quickly that, like, I love that you mentioned, like, the Agam Lake Agam thing. That's, mm-hmm. like, a very fun memory for me.
Oh, did you go to Azuri?
I did.
Okay.
And I wanted to ask, like, I noticed when I went to Azuri, there were a lot of people who, after they did Chalutzim, I only went there for Chalutzim. I saw that a lot of people that went there, like, they would come back for Avodah, they would come back and become, like, counselors or whatever. It seemed like there was a really big difference in, like, the way that everybody spoke Hebrew after that, especially to, like, the Israeli counselors and, like, how much of it they knew. But it seemed to me that, like, every Israeli counselor would only speak Hebrew to anybody that had done Chalutzim.
Wow.
So I was wondering if you, like, noticed anything about that, if you have any more information about that, because that kind of interested me while I was there.
Oh, that's really cool. So I'll just give you a little more background. What's your name? Samir is talking about a camp in Wisconsin that is part of the Reform movement and is unusual in that it has a Hebrew immersion program for kids going into 9th and 10th, I think, grade?
I think it was going into 10th.
Okay. And it's like 6 weeks of Hebrew and intensive Hebrew, right? The kids speak English in the bunks and when they're not, you know, in class, but there's a lot of class and a lot of times when they're just supposed to be speaking Hebrew. I didn't really observe kids after that age group, so I did most of my observations there and younger. And so I don't know, I didn't observe the counselors continuing to speak Hebrew to them, but that wouldn't surprise me because that camp is so oriented toward Hebrew that the fact that they have the oldest age group as the Hebrew immersion program implies that it's like the thing that they're all looking forward to, and it's the pinnacle of the camp experience, and so it makes sense that after that they would continue, that the Israeli counselors would continue to speak Hebrew to people who've done that program, expecting that they've learned enough to be able to understand. Other questions?
I was wondering if you found any differences in like conversational style across different groups within Judaism?
Yes, thank you for asking about conversational style. So there's been some interesting research on by Deborah Tannen and Deborah Schifrin on the language of Jews from New York in particular. So you may have heard that Jews interrupt. We don't interrupt, we just overlap, okay? And so that means, overlapping means that there's someone's talking and then someone else starts talking before that person finishes talking, right? And so it's known as a highly engaged speech style. And so Deborah Tannen's article on this focuses on a Thanksgiving dinner that had some non-Jews from California and some Jews from New York, maybe some Jews from California too, but the New York Jews were much more engaged in their speech style, and it was seen as off-putting to the Californians. And this is true for many groups where you have people who have different understandings of what conversational style should be and how engaged and how much overlapping is okay. And they just, it leads to some conflicts. And then Deborah Schifrin's article on this talked about Jewish argument as sociability, the idea that people argue as a way of being social. It doesn't mean they're mad at each other, but you know, you get people who aren't from Jewish backgrounds or aren't from New York saying, oh, it sounded like your family was mad at each other. What? No, what do you mean? We were having a great time. Like, that's just how we hang out, you know? And this has gotten a lot of attention in various ways. I did study this in my survey in 2008. I asked, have people told you that you interrupt too much? And Jews were much more likely than non-Jews to say yes to that, and including people who weren't from New York. But we also had New York features. I know you didn't ask about this, but I'll just tell you anyway, that we had on the survey, we asked about various New York linguistic features. So we asked people, how do you pronounce the words orange and horrible in Florida, or orange, horrible in Florida? Here, you guys in this region, you would say horrible, right? In New York, they would say horrible. And people who are Jewish, among those who are not from New York, Jews are more likely than non-Jews to say they use the New York pronunciations. What's going on there? Well, a lot of Jews have historical ties to New York, like their parents lived there, but we found that even controlling for that, we found that that was still a significant difference. Controlling for whether their parents are from New York and whether they have lived in New York at any time. And so really what's going on here is, I think, social networks, that Jews are more likely to have lived in New York, and Jews who haven't lived in New York are more likely to have hung out with those Jews who've lived in New York. And so I think it influences it. I am not from New York. I grew up in Maryland, where people would say orange. But I say orange because, and I think part of it is that my parents partly grew up in New York. And so I think I, as a firstborn child, I think I'm more influenced by my parents than my younger siblings are, who say orange instead of orange. So anyway, there's an interesting birth order effect that we didn't ask about in the survey, but I think that would be an interesting study to look at. Like, you know, people moving from one region to another. I think you've done some research on that. And did you look at birth order?
No, I've never looked at birth order.
It would be interesting. Okay, other questions?
Did you observe any converts and were there any like differences that, if you did observe them?
Yes. So in my study of becoming frum, there were some people who had converted to Judaism, and I found that they were quite similar to those who grew up Jewish but not Orthodox, except that sometimes they had a little more trouble pronouncing the ch sound. But that was also true for Jews who grew up not with much Jewish education or engagement. I haven't actually looked at that as a factor in the survey, but I should do that. I should look at that. It's a good idea.
you. So, Sarah, I know that some of your more recent work has been thinking about names, and your bar mitzvah reminded me that you've been looking into Jewish pet names, yes, as well as names of actual human Jews. Yes. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what you found so far.
Sure. Well, let me ask, how many of you have a pet? Okay, does anyone have a pet with a name that you consider Jewish? What's yours?
Amit, which is Hebrew for buddy.
Ah, that's cute. Amit, okay.
Well, it's Toby, which was the name that I would have liked to give to one of my children, but I couldn't because my husband's middle name is Tov, which would be the Hebrew equivalent of Toby.
Yeah.
And you know, there's an Ashkenazi European Jewish custom that you don't give children names of people who are living. And so Toby had to go to the dog.
Cute. Cute. I have a dog named Libby, which is an English name, but also Hebrew Libi, meaning my heart, and it's Yiddish Libe, meaning love. So a lot of Jews have pets. Most of them just have regular American names like Coco and Fluffy, but some of them have distinctively Jewish names, and they tend to come from various sources. Historical figures. So you get a lot of dogs named Rashi, which is a medieval rabbi, and you get a lot of, and one iguana actually, and you get a lot of. So like, there's a lot of punny historical names. So there's Golda Meow, and there's. There's a number of Ruthie Bader Ginsburg. You know, puns or just dogs named Ruthie Bader Ginsburg. And there's, there's a lot of biblical characters, right? And sometimes it's names from the Bible that would be less common among humans. So like Amos, there's a bunch of dogs named Amos, and Vashti is one, is a pretty common one. So historical figures. Then you have names of foods, which is a common, and these are all common trends among American dog names to name after historical figures, often with a pun, right? Like Rosa Barks and Julius Caesar. But then you have names of foods, which is also quite common, like Peanut and what's another dog name or cat name that's like a name of a food? Snickers. There you go. What? Candy?
Jimmy. Sprinkles.
Oh, yeah, there you go. So that's common, but then Jews often do this with Jewish food. So you get a lot of dogs named Babka or Kishka or know any other dogs or cats with food names?
PJ Library.
I knew a wiener dog named Bagel.
Oh, that's cute. A bagel dog. That's cute. Okay, what?
There's a PJ Library book where the dog is called Kugel.
Oh, that's cute. Yeah.
One of my friends has a cat named Loaf, like loaf of bread.
Aw, cute. Okay.
Yeah, just Loaf.
Yeah. And then there's a Sephardic dog named Boreka, and they call him, which is like relevant here, and they call him Bo. There, Boreka. They call him Bo. So Boreka and Boreka is the same word, just different dialects, right, of Ladino. And they call him Bo, which is a great name for a dog because it's also the Hebrew word for come. So you see there's a lot of wordplay here, right? Okay, so there's historical figures, there's foods, there's Jewish holidays. So there's a lot of animals that are named after the Jewish holiday around which they were adopted. So like a dog named Dreidel that's adopted around Hanukkah, or a dog named Afikoman that's adopted around Passover. Purim characters like Morty, Mordechai for Purim, or Tashi for Hamantashen. Yeah, there's like a lot of creative ways to name after holidays. And then just some random Jewish values or Jewish terms, a lot of Yiddish words. There's one cat named Lachenkop, which literally means a hole in the head because that person needed another cat like they needed a hole in the head. And then there's Alta Cocker, which is, Maxie, but Maxie's Jewish name is Alta Cocker, which means old pooper, but it is also a Cocker Spaniel, and so it's really cute. And this part works better with the pictures, but you know, I didn't bring those. So anyway, and there's just others that are just Jewish concept like mitzvah and tikva. It's actually a pretty common one for people who get a pet shortly after a loved one dies, and it's like their hope for the future. Yeah.
Yeah.
You have the... Here, I'll pass it over. Yep.
Hi, thank you for the wonderful talk. I just wanted to, there's the songs with the Davy Crockett and then Big Bad Moshe and Big Bad, it's almost a subgenre of Westerns where they Yiddishize them. There's the Ballad of Irving, Frank Gallup, 1960s, which is Big Bad Irving, the 142nd fastest gun in the West. Oh, even on the range, he kept two sets of dishes.
Yeah.
There's Alan Sherman,
yeah.
The streets of Laredo becomes the streets of Miami.
Uh-huh.
And there, it's not so much Yiddish, but it's more like, I'll never go back to the old Fontainebleau. It's about Miami hotels that serve Jews. But there's also this kind of discourse of masculinity going on in these songs, where it's about the Western is John Wayne and this sort of macho sort of figure, and we're going to Yiddishize it into Delancey Street and into sort of Taylor's, and this kind of, you know, it's a more complicated set of recognitions about. Part of it is just let's Yiddishize the West,
mm-hmm.
But there's something about the discourse of America going on, especially in the. It was interesting to hear the Moshe version because that must be more recent, right?
Yeah, that was from. I think the 80s probably,
yeah. Yeah, and two live Jews doing, you know, Luther Campbell and that kind of thing. So you see this kind of way that it gets used to signify something about masculinity, something a little nebbishy, a little bit on that level, where there's this kind of pleasure of recognition that's going on. And they are going on, like, as you showed, linguistically at very, very different levels. Sometimes it's just one Yiddish word or just a custom.
Mm-hmm.
But other times it's pretty intricate in how it's sort of embedded and the audience is there. And it reminded me, like, Weber and Fields, do you know them? Because the Hyman Kaplan stuff is all out of, like, these old vaudeville bits that come from starting about 1900 or so. And there's even, like, non-Jewish versions of that double Dutch German sort of speaking that you yeah. find pretty common. But he's writing that in the, Rosten's writing, what, 60s?
Yeah, I think that's from, yeah. No, that might have been earlier. I'm not sure.
Yeah. So you kind of have this sense of, they're playing with certain American stereotypes.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe Kinky Friedman is another person to think about in relationship to that whole idea, because it's really rich. And you just had great examples there, but it was just a thought as you were speaking.
Oh, thank you. This is great. Yeah, I mean, that whole Mickey Katz and Country Yossi really calls for a lot more analysis. And you're right, the juxtaposition of the, you know, the stereotypically nebbishy city Jew with the country music, I think, is really intentionally discordant. I think Mickey Katz's nasal voice quality plays into that stereotype.
Yeah, that's really true. It's also part of the Western, like, it's there in Cooper. Like, you have the city slicker who doesn't know the ways of the West that Natty Bunko has to show.
That's really interesting.
It's really part of the genre.
Well, and then I guess along those same lines, you get Mel Brooks and the
Blazing Saddles,
right? And so, you know, there you have it's a movie from, what was it, the 60s, 70s?
72.
Okay, where there's this a famous scene where Mel Brooks is playing an Indian and he's talking to his fellow Indian in Yiddish. That it's supposed to be an Indian language, or it's in kind of more Yinglish, there's so much to analyze there. Actually, I did write about that in a paper about non-Jews' use of Jewish language, but also how Yiddish became part of comedy in America, partly through things like that. So yeah, I think there's a lot going on there with language and masculinity and Native Americans also, and there's also various vaudeville Yiddish vaudeville acts about Indians in interesting ways that are problematic, but also, you know, they were maybe progressive for their time, right? Yeah. Do we have?
I really enjoyed your talk and also stuff about interrupting or playing along and argumentation. I really find interesting as well. So you had these kind of surveys of Yiddish and different Hebrew words and whether they're declining or rising in terms of age and where what spectrum you are on a certain Jewish identity. But I don't know, it wasn't as visible if you're comparing the two. So for instance, I don't know if one would expect kind of a relatively equal number of Yiddish and Hebrew words that most American Jews will use. Again, I'm sure there are different categories. I guess I'm asking if you compare the number of Yiddish and Hebrew words, or I don't know if you've done that, that people are, American Jews are currently using, would it be approximately the same number for most American Jews, or how what are your findings in terms of comparing them side by side?
Yeah, great question. I don't know about the overall numbers of words that people use because we only asked about a limited number on the survey, but we could do that kind of analysis and see like how many they said they used, and you know then I think we did that. We had an index of loanword use and it really does correlate with denomination and with time spent in Israel. So no, they don't use the same number. Those quotes I showed at the beginning where it's all very different, I forgot to mention that anyone who says one of those quotes would be pretty unlikely to say any of those other quotes, right? So somebody who says, I left my karacha in Knis would not say, I'm going to my nono's meldado, and would not say, you must be kvelling about your grandson, he's a machet, right? So yes, they use different words, but they also use different numbers of words. So Jews who are more engaged in Jewish communal life, have more Jewish friends, have spent more time in Israel, have more Jewish education, are more likely to use more words than those who haven't, who've done that less.
I was curious as you were talking about other sort of levels of a dialect. So we've been talking a lot about lexicon, which is a little bit easier to sort of agentively choose. And I'm wondering, it's this harder to get at with a survey, but I'm wondering about pronunciation, right? So there's certain phonological features of Jewish English that you don't have to use a single word of Yiddish, but it'll still mark you as a Jew. So I'd love to hear a little bit about that, the sort of subconscious pronunciation stuff, or maybe it's also agentive.
Yeah, well, there has been some research on this, right? So there's a study of Grand Rapids, Michigan Jews, and looking at certain vowels like aw versus ah, and I can't remember exactly which. Oh, did they do the ah? Not sure which vowels they did in that study. But then there's some in New York and Boston. There's a few studies from the 60s to the 90s about that question, about vowel use. They did find that Jews had some differences from their non-Jewish neighbors in that, as well as other ethnic groups like Italians and Irish. They were doing something different with their vowels. There's very little research on that, although I did just read an article on London, on Jews in London using vowels, like slight differences in their vowels. And it was specifically about, did you read that article?
No, I just lived the experience.
Oh, okay. But it was specifically.
We say certain words differently, like American Jews say shaitel and we say shaitel.
Oh no, but it wasn't that. It wasn't in loan words. It was specifically in English words that were not from, you know, just regular English words.
Yeah.
But this was in the Orthodox community. And I can't remember if it was in exactly where it was, but anyway, they did have major differences between Orthodox Jews and non-Jews. But the interesting thing is the gender differences, because in that community, there's a big gender difference in men are more likely to use Yiddish than women, mm-hmm. and there was a lot more Yiddish influence in their vowels. But to answer you, we need more research on that. You know, we need more research on, because I think there's something really going on, especially among Orthodox Jews in their vowels, like the less, like that the vowel shift is not happening as much in those communities, right? And so we got at that a little bit in the survey by asking about the New York vowels, but we didn't get at the regional things. Like, I wonder, people in Michigan are more likely to say like bad or salad. So are Jews less likely to say that? Or are they just as likely as their non-Jewish neighbors to say it? There's some research on Chicago now. Annette D'Onofrio and Ben, what's his name? Anyway, people are starting to look at this, but there's a lot more work to be done. And if anyone's interested in sociophonetics, this would be a great topic to do research on, like getting a sample of Jews around the country, non-Jews around the country from those same places, from similar socioeconomic classes, and to what extent are they, what are they doing with their vowels?
I think it would also be interesting to see, like, when people are in, like, a more performance mode, when they're clearly trying to index, like, I am this type of American Jew, does their pronunciation also ramp up at the same time? Like, are they doing more word final T release and, mm-hmm. like, other...
Oh, right, I forgot to mention, I have done some research on word final T release, which is, like, you say right instead of right. And a lot of people do this. I mean, it's very common in England, but in America... people do this for various reasons, like to sound smart, or there's some research on gay men doing this, and there's some research on people in various groups doing it. I did some research on Orthodox Jews and found that men released their T more than women, but women did also release their T's a lot. I analyze that as being part of a learned persona that in the Orthodox world, there's an expectation that especially men will be learned, and by releasing your T's, you're saying, you know, like, no, I'm not. You know, you're like sounding a little more learned, and also being maybe more like you're expressing. Sometimes people would do it more when they're being impatient, like, no, I'm not. You know, like that kind of thing. So, and then there's another thing. I just did a little click there, like that click. That is another feature. I mean, there's a lot more that I didn't talk about here, but that's one other feature that you get. It's actually an influence from Israeli Hebrew, where there are multiple clicks. So you can say, meaning no, and then there's, which is a hesitation marker that comes in the middle of a sentence, like, we went there and then we decided, whatever, it doesn't matter, that click. Anyway, that click is quite common in Orthodox communities, even among people who've never been to Israel, because it just spreads in the social networks of Orthodox communities in America.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, okay. Thanks. Thank you so much. It was fantastic. So I have a question that kind of branches off from the camp question, like two parts, and it is kind of about education. So I'm just in thinking about this listening. So I only have like the words of Yiddish, right, from family, from my parents, right, but I find myself like purposely using them with my children and translating them for my children, like if they don't understand them. Like I find myself wanting to communicate that to them. And
like
so
what are some examples?
Geschlafen, I say to go to bed, which even my parents didn't say that to me.
Wow.
And I'm trying to think of what my dad like would teach me, like, was this stuff on meine Leben? What do you want from my life? And so I say that to them sometimes, and I tell them that what that means, right? Which I, like, my dad would use as a joke, right? And I'm thinking about, I can't remember, but there's a few other things, right, that I will, like, purposely, like, use with them because I want them to have it, I think, like, you know?
Yeah.
And so I was thinking about it when you were talking about camp, and I guess I'm wondering if you asked people in the survey about that kind of phenomenon, whether people are sort of thinking about translating it to their kids or communicating it and making it something that is like perpetuated. And then as a corollary to that, or as a jumping off, also thinking about the camp.
Mm-hmm.
So my daughter was at, you know, Habanim, we were talking to the camp director, and she was talking about what a pain in the butt it was going to be because they were getting accredited, and she had to translate all that stuff into English, right, for the accreditation. But I didn't think to ask her, but I was thinking when you were saying it, like, do they also include, like, that this is educational? Mm. We, you know, is she just going to translate it to make it easier for them, or is she actually also going to say, we also use these terms in order to be able to teach kids this language? Mm. Or do is that just kind of, like, embedded and it's not conscious?
No, I think it is conscious. So, okay, to answer your first one, I think we didn't ask about that on our survey. We did ask, do you feel that your language has gotten more or less distinct over the last, I forget what we said, few decades or whatever? And we were surprised. I mean, we weren't surprised. More people said more distinct, mm-hmm. and which is it makes sense because Jewish English is becoming more distinct, right, in certain ways. But, and then yes, I think it is consciously pedagogical. In my session tomorrow, I'll talk about the camp director's goals. And we find that we thought, you know, more camps would have goals around Hebrew education, like that they want kids to learn Hebrew. It's pedagogical in a different way. Their goals are about connection. You know, they're using these Hebrew words to foster an environment of Hebrew richness and to make kids excited about Hebrew and to make kids excited about being Jewish, not to teach Hebrew. Mm-hmm. But in some camps, that is a goal, especially in the Ramah camps, which is part of the conservative movement. That is a big goal. And they actually want their kids to learn Hebrew. And so there, those Hebrew plays are much more common, like musicals in Hebrew, which really does teach a lot of words. You know, we've talked to alumni who had gone there 30, 40, 50 years ago, and they remembered the songs. Mm. And so much that whenever they hear these songs, they think about the Hebrew version. Mm. So, like, someone had, it was, well, let's see if I can remember, Sergeant Pepper's. So it was like, I forget how she sang it, but she, now whenever she hears Sergeant Pepper's, she thinks of it in Hebrew, and she remembers her camp experience fondly. Mm-hmm. And so that really serves an important purpose. Maybe it teaches some Hebrew, and people did report, like, oh yeah, I went to Israel, and I was sitting down on the bench, and someone said something about the safsal, and I remembered, oh, safsalim ala shulchanot, which is what they say when you say put the benches on the table at the end of the meal in the dining hall, the chadar ochel. And so she, that word safsal was in her head from that routinized Hebrew phrase that's used at her camp, and it helped her when she was in Israel. But for the most part, people, you know, the effects are more about fostering ideological links between Jews, Hebrew, and the camp environment than about teaching the language.
Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, for anybody here who's interested in the talk tomorrow, we've got extra seats in my classroom, which Nick knows. So you guys are all invited. It's tomorrow at 12:40 in Wells 156, I believe.
132. 132 is part of the okay, I think we're just about out of time, right?
So. Yes, we are exact. Yeah. Wow, that to the moment. All right. Well, thank you so much. Everybody, like, join in thanking Sarah. Thank you so much for a fabulous talk and fabulous questions, too. Before you go.